when disaster strikes. Will you be ready?
Good evening, and we begin tonight with the monster hurricane and its deadly impact already.
When all hope is gone, will the government be there for you? If you're looking for ways to take your prepping to the next level, then you've come to the right place. Broadcasting from a secure and well-prepared location, it's time for Prepping 2.0. And now, please welcome authors Glenn Tate and Shelby Gallagher.
Well, hello, everyone. It's episode 27 of Prepping 2.0, the podcast about prepping at the next level. We have a good one for you.
Well, it's podcast and the radio show. We are a radio show.
Thank you. I said radio show. Yes, the show. Shelby, tell folks, are we just a podcast or are we on a bunch of radio stations?
Goodness gracious, no. We have graduated, and we're excited because we have a new radio station that's joined us.
Tell everybody about the radio station.
We are now broadcast in, I believe, Northern Idaho and St. Mary's, in that area, on KOFE. Welcome to all of our new radio listeners in the Idaho area.
Yes, this is great. And by the way, folks out there listening on, say, the podcast, let your radio stations in the area know if you've got, like, a conservative talk station or something. Have them give us a call. We'd love to be on their radio station. You can hear us on the radio too. Well, we have a great topic, and that is something a lot of people always ask us questions about, and that is, what should I look for in a bug out location? And we have
We always have to jump in here. Sorry, I got to catch you there. We always want to also talk about the top 100 things that disappear in a collapse. Which is great. And so folks can go see this list. It's on our website at prepping2-0.com. And we try to do one of these items every show that we do. And it's developed out of collapses that have happened in other places around the world, particularly Bosnia. And we're on number 17 this week. I love this topic because you'll see why in just a minute. Number 17 on the list is silver and gold.
Yes, a little Christmas song is playing in my head right now. Silver and gold. I'm a terrible singer. I think we've all realized that. By the way, the singing you just heard is the only singing you'll ever hear of me on a radio station, because it's not like it would ever be music people would want. So anyway, me singing on a talk show.
Oni, we're good at talking.
Yes, silver and gold. A lot of people ask me, where should I get silver and gold? I have no advertising connection. I make no money from this. Folks, I recommend it's the Patriot Trading Group at allamericangold.com. Here's what I like about those guys. They don't hound you. If you, like, you're watching Fox News and it says, hey, you might want to buy silver, call for this free report and get like a ounce of silver. As soon as you give those people your phone number and your email address, you're going to have high pressure cold callers hounding you for the rest of your life. And quite honestly, life's too short for that. Also, I don't want anyone to know I have gold and silver. I especially don't want some boiler room operation, you know, in some strip mall in Tampa, Florida. These people calling me screaming that, you know, I'm a crazy guy if I don't buy a ton of silver tomorrow. So that's why I like All American Gold. They've been in business for decades. Guess how many Better Business Bureau complaints they have, Shelby?
I'm going to guess none.
Zero. Yes.
That's kind of cool.
That is kind of cool. And I've been listening to their show, Patriot Radio News Hour, for a long time, for years. And so they're good guys. So All American Gold, Double J. It's Joe Jaquin. That's where the double J comes from. He runs the thing. Give him a call. Tell him Glenn and Shelby on Prepping 2.0 sent you. And he'll say, who? But that's okay. That's okay. So anyway, that's our recommendation. It's obvious why you would need gold and silver. I think especially silver, by the way.
Yeah.
I feel pretty strongly. A lot of times I'm pretty laissez-faire and, oh, hey, whatever works in your situation. That's not going to be true in this case. Unless you have a bunch of money, like stupid amounts of money. And then go ahead and get gold. But if you are a normal person listening to this, I think silver makes a ton of sense because smaller denominations. An ounce of silver, $18. The second I say this, somebody will go, the spot price is $19.25. Or maybe it's down to
$7. It's roughly that area.
It's about that much.
Yeah.
Which means 1 ounce is you know, a manageable amount. If you have a gold bar, because you think that James Bond movie you saw as a kid was really cool and you want to have a gold bar. By the way, I'd love to have a gold bar. I'm not going to lie. I would love to have a gold bar. It's just not really practical if I need like a loaf of bread.
Yeah, because it's hard to make change.
It's hard to make change. That's right. Get a chisel out. It's like, no. The other thing I highly recommend, and this I don't even think is controversial, so this is an easy recommendation. I go with known quantities, U.S. denominations, silver dollars that are, I think, 0.9 ounces, or it's an ounce, but of 0.9 purity. Everybody knows. You can look at it, and you know it's roughly an ounce of silver. If you've got, like, the I don't know, Moldavia, our King Mugambu is awesome, 20th anniversary silver coin. I mean, I could make that stuff up with just like, you know, basically a hammer and something. I mean, I could just make up coins. And
well, so, you're making it up now.
Yeah, I am. I'm just, I make up a lot of stuff. Well, the things I make up are kind of obviously dumb. So maybe nobody would counterfeit King Mugambo. Did I even say that name the second time?
You said
correctly?
It right the second
okay,
time.
Thank what? You. Wow, I'm proud of myself.
Oh, gosh.
So known quantities, U.S. silver dollars. If you're going to buy gold, you know, silver, or not silver eagles, but 1 ounce gold coins, $20 gold pieces back when an ounce of gold was $20. And if you wonder if there's inflation, you just got the answer in your head when you did the math at like whatever it is, $1,300 an ounce now. And so highly recommend U.S. coins. I guess maybe Canadian coins because, you know, that's not King Mugambu. It's that little punk Trudeau. They're different. But anyway.
The millennial that's running the country. That guy.
That guy. So anyway, stick with
we
that.
We might have just
stuff.
Lost any stations that in Canada, but I don't think we care.
I don't think we care. Okay. We love Canadians, but we don't care about Canadian
the
radio
government.
Stations. We have Canadian Patreon.
Oh,
he lives
welcome.
In Quebec. He's awesome. So those are some thoughts on gold and silver, why you need them. And it's just obvious that you need them. Okay, here's the thing I should also say about gold and silver that is not immediately obvious. And that is gold and silver isn't like 2 days into the collapse. I'm glad I have gold and silver. It's not for that. It's for storing wealth now and for having money, big money. Like an ounce of silver is going to be big money when cash is meaningless. And being able to get things, especially true of gold, it's like a great store of value. It is a way to take Federal Reserve notes that you have today and put them into something that only you know you have and that can't be taken away from you except by like a motorcycle gang. And everything you have can be taken away from you by a motorcycle gang. So that's not a thing. But it's for rebuilding. It's for a year into a collapse. And you need some building materials to build a giant chicken coop on your property that you've selected because Brian at Strategic Landscape Design has told you you should, and we'll get to him in a moment. It's for those kinds of things. It's for the medium and long term.
Well, it's for when cash or money, Federal Reserve money, loses its value. How do we know this happens? We've seen it in previous collapses. Look at the footage that's coming out of Venezuela right now where there's their currency is paving the streets as like trash because there is no value to it. Gold and silver holds its value.
Exactly. Always have.
Always has.
Always will. Should people take every ounce of money they have or every penny they have and put it in nothing but gold and silver coins? Nope. Layering. We talk about layering with food
all the time.
Preps. We talk about layering with self-defense. And the same applies to money. Have some gold and silver. You'll kick yourself
for not doing
paying,
it.
Paying, you know, about $19 an ounce now when all is said and done for some good silver coins from somebody like All American Gold. Here's the other cool thing about All American Gold. Not only do they not hound you, they don't keep track of who they sold stuff to. And it's funny, they'll say this, instead of hounding you, you pick up the phone, you call their phone number and you say, I'd like to buy today's special if that's what you want. And they say, okay. They take your address because they got to ship it to you. By the way, you can drive to Phoenix and go pick it up if you want, but that doesn't apply to many people. And they will never talk to you again. So that's
go.
A cool thing.
Yeah, very cool.
So we have a great guest. And by the way, we are here in Prosser, Washington. Did I say Washington? Prosser Liberty.
Yes,
Prosser
say it correctly.
Is in the eastern half of the former state of Washington. We all call it Liberty because we think Liberty is going to be what Western or Eastern Washington used to be. So Prosser, we're at the Northwest Preparedness Expo and there's a guy we know, a guy we've got to know well, we've talked to a lot, Brian from Strategic Landscape Design. He's at the show too. So we said, what are you doing tonight? And he said, I was going to have dinner with my family. And we said, that's dumb. Don't do that. Yeah. Why don't you record a podcast episode with us? And he said,
a radio show.
Oh, did I do it again?
You did.
Yes.
It's just hard to break this habit. Oh, yes, geez, it's okay.
Thank you. Record a show with us. And then he said, I don't even like my wife and kids. And I said, I'm not going to say that on the radio. Podcast.
You're learning quickly.
So anyway, welcome, Brian. Thank you for being here.
Oh, thank you so much for having me.
Excellent. So tell us about your company and what you do, because people want to know.
Great. Well, thanks. So Strategic Landscape Design is a consulting and design company. And essentially, what we do is we help people select a property if they've not yet purchased one that can really meet their needs long term and help achieve their goals for living a more self-sufficient and resilient lifestyle. And then we also help folks who already have property with the planning and design to develop that property over time to help achieve those goals that they have. We really help folks cover the primary needs of being able to access water on their property, which is, of course, vital to being able to be self-sufficient and last into the future, and food production methods and systems to feed themselves and their family and maybe members of their community over time, and not have to be so reliant on outside resources in the grocery store, whether that's today or in the future. We also help folks with thinking about either being off-grid or having just a backup power system or source and that kind of energy production. And then a key to all of this, in my mind, is helping them integrate security features throughout all of the improvements they're making on their property so that it's something that's just natural and inherent with whatever they do. So that's kind of the general synopsis. We started out by really focusing where our business is located in North Idaho and working with folks within that kind of heart of the American Redoubt, as John Jacob Schmidt likes to say. And we've now really expanded those services and are now offering remote consulting services so that we can use online data that's available to us, as well as data that our clients provide us with. It might be photographs of the property, maybe even like a Skype video tour, and take all that information so that we can make recommendations without having to actually travel to their location. And they might choose to do that as a means of helping to secure their OPSEC or just from a cost perspective to help keep those costs down. So either option works, and we're happy to help people come up with a plan that's going to really help them achieve their goals long term.
And that's what's so cool, and that's what's changed, is now you're doing this nationally. Because when we spoke almost a year ago, I said, oh, it'd be so cool if we ever have a podcast, because we didn't have a podcast then. It was just another one of Glenn's crazy ideas. But you said, well, you know what? I'm limited to North Idaho because I go and I tour the properties. And I said, oh, what a bummer, because people all over the country and, by the way, in Canada, like Quebec, among other places, they could really use a consultant, and now you do that, and you do it nationally, and that's what's changed, and that's why we have you on the show. Because can you imagine, Shelby and I are going to tell a story about one of our neighbors here in a moment, but can you imagine picking out, you finally got a new job, and you move, and you uproot your life, one of the biggest changes possible you could do, and you go and you have this piece of property, and you don't know what you're doing. You're just like buying it because it looks cool. And a realtor, we're going to talk more about that. No offense to realtors out there, but when it comes to like precision expertise on bug out locations, you're going to want to do better than a garden variety realtor who's not thinking about these sorts of things. Now, when it comes to like good schools in the suburbs, they probably know everything about that. They don't know about this. So the story Shelby and I have is our neighbor at our real place that we have, nice couple. They moved. They haven't moved yet. They're in the Seattle area, and they were going to have a dream country log home kind of place, and they got the lot next to ours. And Shelby, what are two bad things that happened? Because they weren't they didn't have somebody like Brian, and they weren't like paying attention to the details of this biggest purchase of their life. What are two things that happened?
Well, one of two things. First of all, they don't live on the property. They're not. That's what I think their goal is, and they hired a logger who basically said, "Yeah, I can log your property, and you'll make money off that timber, and most likely pay for your house." Well, they logged the property. They devastated the property. It is no longer a pristine forest. It was like just mowed down of trees. It wasn't selective logging. It wasn't done. It was done pretty hastily. It was done in a couple of days on 5 acres. So that's the first problem. So they came back to their property after seeing this logging that just happened, and were very disappointed. And that's putting it mildly. The next thing is, and this is where someone like Brian is very helpful, is that they were told by their realtor, "Oh yeah, there's water. You can get water here. You just need to dig a well." Well, not really. They come to find out that you, in this area, there's a maximum number of wells that you can have, and that and this area has been maxed out. There's no more permits for digging wells. So these people have a piece of property that they cannot get any water access to without drilling a brand new. In other words, they can't access the community well. I need to step back there. They have to drill a whole brand new well at what, $1,000 per what did
well we, it's I want to say $40 a foot. It's going to be between 400 and 500 feet, they estimate. So that's 16,000 to 20,000. And I love well drillers. I know them. I think they're awesome people. They don't really know. It could be 25, it could be $30,000. Can you imagine this property you just bought for your dream? And all of a sudden, at a minimum, you've got a $30,000, well, not a minimum, but you've got this unknown cost for something that you need, like water. It kind of takes the fun out
right.
of it.
Right, and you don't know. You don't know. And it's, no matter what, it's going to be expensive. This isn't just buying a new TV kind of a thing. This is a... It is a capital expense just so that you can live on it. This isn't a convenience. This is a necessity. So I know that one of the last conversations you had with these kind folks, they were kind of like... they're devastated. This was supposed to be a dream property where they retire, where they like have their grandkids come, and now they're at a standstill because they got to figure this out. So that's where people like Brian come in. It's like they can help you. That's what I want to talk about, how you can ask those not just standard questions a realtor will give you, but those key questions. So Brian, tell us if you are looking for property, what are kind of some of those key questions to ask and look for?
Yeah, that's a great question, Shelby. Water being so fundamental, as you've indicated, one of the first things I'd say to piggyback on this really sad story would actually be to go in with the key question of understanding what are the water resources on the property that I'm looking at, and what are my legal rights to accessing that water. For anyone who either lives in or is looking to buy property west of the Mississippi River, the reality is that in the western states, water rights are a big deal. And that's not true back east. Water rights aren't a thing. It's not a problem. Water is abundant. But when you're out west, you need to understand, for example, that water rights in most states are separate from the actual property itself and do not always automatically convey with the property when it's purchased. And while I'm not an attorney, I can tell you that you do need to verify these facts as an informed buyer.
And I am an attorney, and I can tell you to listen to Brian. See, there we go. I'm going to send everybody a bill for that legal advice. No, he's dead on, and this is a huge thing. Please continue.
Yeah, so just, you know, again, just to highlight, ask the right questions and get the facts before making a final decision. A lot of times there are entities within each state that are responsible for administering the rights to the use of water. And so having either yourself knowing who that is or having the right person contact those entities, those agencies to get the facts and get the right information is really helpful. And if there are water rights associated with a property you want to purchase, again, make sure that's worked into the deal and that you're getting a good value and understanding the cost. Also understanding what those water rights apply to. In some states, such as Idaho, you could have a water right, let's say, to a creek that exists when you buy the property, but the types of uses of that water right is granted for might be less than or different than what you were intending. Let's say it's only applicable to your domestic house water and at a certain volume, when you also want to be able to use it to water your livestock and irrigate your pasture and your gardens. Well, if the water right wasn't granted for that, you haven't been given the legal right to use those additional quantities. So that's something you need to understand going into it. So again, when you're making that, you know, that large investment, as you've indicated, maybe the largest investment some people will make in their lifetime, you can't do enough due diligence, in my opinion, to really understand what you're buying and what the costs are ultimately.
Yeah, and here's the thing, and I mentioned it earlier, but it deserves repetition. A standard realtor, as awesome as he or she may be, isn't thinking about how you're going to water livestock, because they're thinking, I mean, what, you can water a cat with like tap water. I mean, they're not even thinking. They're like in Suburbiaville for the most part. And there are a handful of exceptions, but why risk it? So yeah, water. Well, there are four things to look for. You mentioned early, we've covered water. What's number two?
Number two would be food production. So the key here is, how many people are you planning to feed on your property? Whether that's today, tomorrow, or in the future, you might have a family of four at the moment, and you might anticipate maybe in a post-collapse situation that you're going to have five or six more relatives show up, or maybe some folks in the community, and you'd really like to be able to, say, feed 12 people. Well, understanding those numbers is going to make a big difference when assessing your property and determining which food production types or systems are going to work the best for you. And when we say food production types or systems, I'm talking about things like small-scale livestock, chickens, pigs, goats, maybe getting up into cattle, whether they're beef cattle or dairy cattle, and then things like the difference between a perennial garden and an annual garden. And those differences can be really important and fundamental to your success. And so we need to understand what those are and how they work with your particular property and if they meet your goals and needs.
Yeah, and we're going to talk about each one of these topics in more detail when we come back in the second segment. We have a minute or two left in this first segment. So there was water and food preparation. What is the third one, the third of the four?
The third would be energy production or energy generation, so that you're either creating an off-grid situation or at least having a backup power supply.
And that could be solar, I guess, a little teeny dam, right?
Micro hydroelectric, micro wind turbines. You could get into even some crazy things like wood gas. So there's a lot of options out there, some of which are types people may have never even heard of before.
Right. And of course, the topography in your particular piece of land, it's going to have a big bearing when it comes to the wind that's coming through. By the way, again, no disrespect to realtors. How many realtors you go, hey, this is great. I know how many kids in the school district are on free school lunches, but can you tell me what the average wind is here? And they'll be like, what? What are you, fly kites? What are you, crazy?
Exactly.
Why would this even matter? Well, we'll pick up in the second segment on each of these topics and more, and then we're going to also talk about the fourth topic, which is security. So, hey, everybody, stick with us and learn how to pick out a bug out location with an expert who does this for a living, Brian of Strategic Landscape Design. See you in the next episode or the next segment. Thanks.
We'll be right back with more of Prepping 2.0 with authors Shelby Gallagher and Glenn Tate right after this.
PrepperNet, where preppers unite. Looking to meet other like-minded people in your area? Looking to start your own prepper group? Already have a group? Join PrepperNet.com. PrepperNet has gathered the biggest names in the industry to help unite preppers everywhere. Join John Jacob Schmidt, Scott Hunt, Dr. Bones and Nurse Amy, Glenn Tate, Shelby Gallagher, Charlie Hogwood, Samuel Culper, Survivor Jane, Rick Austin, Franklin Horton, Ryan Mitchell, and Brian Duff. Our team is united. Check us out at PrepperNet. .com. PrepperNet, where preppers unite. PrepperNet.com.
Hi, this is Glenn Tate. I wanted to let you know about the ammo supply place that I go to. There's no endorsements. Nobody's paying me anything. They're just good guys. Ammo Supply Warehouse. Ammo Supply Warehouse. Butch out there will take care of you. You know, prepping 1.0 is getting ammunition by the box. Prepping 2.0 is getting a case. You need to have at least a case of ammo for every gun.
Shelby Gallagher here. For all the ladies out there, you can never have enough ammo.
The Operator G1 is a full-featured, rugged comm solution designed for the Midland MXT-100 and 105. Using the GMRS bands, there is no ham license required and no test needed for operation. Ideal for preppers, hunters, homesteaders, ranchers, and people just like you. If you recognize the value of wireless communication with or without grid power, the Operator G1 is an award-winning solution that allows simple, one-button communication when it counts. Our two-year warranty, quality materials, and first-class assembly technicians deliver a high-value solution when you need to be sure you can get your comms up. To learn more, go online to portableuniversalpower.com.
And we're back with more of Prepping 2.0 with authors Glenn Tate and Shelby Gallagher.
Welcome back, everyone. I'm Shelby Gallagher, and this is the second half of our show, Prepping 2.0, for today. Our guest today is Brian with Strategic Landscape Design, and we just kind of hit on the first four topics, or first four things that people should look for in property if they're looking for property. What are those, Glenn?
I feel like this is a lightning round, and this is a quiz, and I have the answer for you, and that is the four are water, food production, energy, and security.
So, and the other thing I want to talk about, and just to bring this up, we've talked about if you're looking for property, but then there's those of us out here who also have property already. So it's good to think about these things too. As you start to develop your property more to be more prepping minded, more to be useful to you in a prepping way instead of just, you know, hey, I want to just put an apple tree in because I think it's pretty, right? So think about those things too. So,
and if I can interrupt you,
sure.
For a moment, that is a key point. I should have emphasized that, and Brian mentioned it, but it needs emphasis. And that is, this isn't just a show for people who are out looking for a bug out property. Brian said that even folks that have a property, he can consult with them and help them make even more out of the property. So if you have a property that you're on that is going to be your bug out location, or that you haven't developed yet, you're still good. Even if you've over, I should state that again. By the way, it's been an expo today, and I've been doing this for like 12 hours. I've been talking to people all day. My voice is shot. I'm a little bit punchy right now, so I'm not as crisp and clear as I usually am.
There you are.
But so even if you're not looking for a parcel, but you have a parcel, Brian can help you. That's my point.
And how to make it really work for you in a grid down situation. So let's hit on one of these. One of them is food production. So what does that mean? That doesn't just mean that, hey, I want to grow some tomatoes next summer, right?
Absolutely, Shelby. It's really something that needs to be kind of calculated. So whenever I'm talking with a client, what I always recommend they do is start by helping me understand how many people it is that they want to be able to feed from their property. And the whole aspect of being more self-sufficient and resilient means that we have to assume you're going to have no outside resources or inputs to help you with that. We really hope that through your sense of community building, like you guys have talked about in other podcasts or other radio shows, that's going to be a factor that will help, but I don't believe it's appropriate to rely on that or to base your planning on that. So really what you want to do is, each mouth that's going to be fed, right, it's a number of calories you need to be able to provide. It's the amount of food that you need to be able to provide. And as you guys have talked about, you want to do layering. We want to have diversity so that there's more resiliency, so that not only do you have a variety of food sources and nutrient types, but also that you have the ability that if one is not producing well this season or this year, you have these backup or alternate systems. So what are we talking about? We're talking about things like, you have your, as you mentioned, the tomatoes, you have your annual garden. Well, annual gardens are super labor intensive and resource intensive because you've got to replant them every year, and you have to have the seeds to do that with, and they take a lot more out of the soil. perennial gardens, for folks that don't know what that means, is it's something that once you plant it, it continues to live throughout all the seasons, gets bigger, produces more year after year after year. So it's really kind of more that just initial investment that you have to make. And once it's established, it's the gift that keeps on giving. Those are way more efficient, way more productive. And then we have all the different types of livestock food systems, your goats, your chickens, your pigs, and something like a family cow. But they all have a different amount of input that's needed and a different amount of land types and space that are required to support them. And so figuring out which ones work best for your property is one of the things that's really important. I will mention that as you think through this, another key factor comes into play that a lot of people tend not to think about up front, and that's, how are you going to feed those animals long term? Because if I can't run 20, 30 miles down to their local feed mill like I used to do anymore, then I need to come up with that feed myself if I'm going to keep this food source perpetually going on my property. And so thinking about feed production to keep the animals as your feed source is one more layer that you need to consider in addition to the food you're eating directly. So it's just another factor that has to be accounted for.
Awesome. So so something to think about, and we'll talk about this, God, we could probably talk about this in another show, is if you have a cow, cows take a lot of graze land, and this is the cost that has to go back and forth. It takes a lot of land to graze on. That land could also be used for a perennial garden. So you need to factor those in. And there's a whole, that's what you do so well, is you do all that math for that a particular family, for a client, on what land they have. So let me ask you this. For that person, this is where I'm so sympathetic, because we can't assume that everyone who listens to our radio show,
And it is a radio
it
show,
is a radio
way.
Show by the
that
way
clear.
That lives in a pristine rural environment with wonderful rolling pastures of golden wheat. There's those folks that live in the city. There's those folks that they're not in a position where they can move right now. There are key things that they can do. It may not be a perfect situation, but they can make it so that their property is a little bit more defensible, better than it was, a little bit more able to produce some of those things. When you talk to those folks in urban environments, what are just some key things someone could do right now to just help kind of shore up those things?
Oh, that's a great question. In fact, I had a really fun conversation with somebody at the expo today who stopped by, and they have that challenge in that urban or suburban environment where all the darn zoning and regulations that say, hey, you can't have chickens, you can't have livestock. Well, if you're willing to push the envelope a little bit, but you don't want to upset the neighbors and have them call the code enforcement officer.
Or the hated homeowners association, the most vile thing on earth. They make, like dictatorial governments throughout history look like child's play. The HOAs are monsters.
Absolutely. So here's kind of, people have heard about guerrilla gardening, where you're sort of, planting food producing things in the nearby neighborhood that no one knows is there. Well, a take on that would actually be, if you have a little shelter, a little backyard, garden shed, you can actually raise meat rabbits in there. They don't sound like roosters, and they don't make a lot of noise, and they don't produce interesting odors the way some of these other critters do. So that's one way to kind of tuck away and hide away a protein source that you can be growing back there. And all you need is, one male and one female. That's your breeding pair. And all of a sudden, you could have 3-4 litters of 8 to 10 rabbits at a time. And hey, you just stored up 20 pounds of protein in the freezer, and nobody even knows what's going on. And all it might take in the backyard is a little annual garden or a small perennial garden that you're using to help feed those. Or heck, if you're not spraying it with all kinds of crazy stuff, you could take your lawn clippings and feed it to the rabbits. Maybe all of a sudden, dandelions, as long as the HOA doesn't come after you,
right.
Dandelions could be a really cool thing to be growing in the lawn, because now when you're picking them, you're going to feed them to the critters. So that's a simple way. Another thing that I love to talk about, because it's kind of fun, is hidden in plain sight gardening, right? So A lot of folks traditionally have either a little bit of a landscape on the front yard or maybe what people call a foundation planting around the house. You can sort of sneak and hide some different plants in with the rest of your plant bed that are food sources, but the average person would have no idea, especially if you pick ones that instead of that shrub that produces that bright red fruit, let's pick one that grows green berries. And they blend in with the color of the leaves, and it's not obvious to anyone that it's there. And so if you slip out after, you know, cover of darkness and pick them at night, you know, your friends and neighbors still aren't going to know what's going on. There are nut-producing shrubs, for example. Let's pick American hazelnut. So that's a really cool shrub because it's hardy in all these northern regions of the U.S., and that will grow literally a hazelnut, but it's wrapped inside of these green leaves that conceal it from all the birds and things until it's fully ripened. And so again, you've got these nuts, fat and protein rich food source growing on these shrubs that blend in with your front yard. And nobody can see that there's actually food being concealed within those shrubs. So it's a little bit of a game because nobody's expecting the plants next to the rose bushes to be something that you're sneaking out at night and grabbing some food off of.
By the way, isn't it sad that here in America we're actually having a conversation about sneaking around in the middle of the night and like harvesting food from your own property? I mean, but I get why. Well, and you were talking about food production and planning for it. I'm guessing one of the things that you do for clients is to look at the climate and the topography and say, okay, this is a shady place. This would be good for these kind of plants. This is out in the sun. This would be good for this. Here's a water source that comes by. Here's a wet area. So is that some of the stuff you do to help folks figure out food production? It's not as simple as saying it would be great to have meat, rabbits, and perennials, because like everybody knows that, but like where do you do it and can you do it and that sort of thing. So describe that, how you help clients with that.
Absolutely. So yeah, we're going to do an assessment of the property first. So we're going to look at things like, what are the terrain features? Like what kind of slopes does the property have? What's the solar orientation? How much sun exposure throughout the day is the property going to get? What are the soils like? Are those soils ready to start growing in today, or do you need to do some improvements or modifications to them? We're also going to look at microclimates. You know, we look at the overall, for those who are familiar with it, the USDA cold hardiness zone, the official mapping that says, hey, it gets this cold on average in the winter, and these kinds of plants, therefore, can grow here and not die off in the cold winter months. Well, we look at that, and that's a general rule of thumb, but then you have to look at the individual property and each location on a property. As you were saying, Glenn, how much of the day is it in sun? Are there rocks, or is there a masonry wall or something that's going to absorb heat and then help to radiate that heat at night when it's cooler and act as a microclimate? Is it shaded? And then pick exactly the right plant materials for each location so that they're going to really thrive and be successful and produce the most possible. Also, believe it or not, a lot of plants, folks don't know this, they have different chemicals and things that they give off between leaves that they drop or their root systems. Some of them will be what they call companion plantings. They'll really work well together with other plants and help each other thrive, while others will actually be fighting for dominance and trying to kind of maintain their territory and pushing out chemicals into the soil and things that will prevent other plants from growing heartily and being successful. So understanding those relationships and being thoughtful will also make a difference with the success of people's gardening style food production.
And I'm guessing that a lot of these same considerations, shade, for example, and water, those apply to livestock too. I mean, you're gonna put animals in a place where they can thrive, and maybe some of the animal byproducts can help some of the surrounding things. So it's this big. See, this is way harder than just like how many kids in a school district are on school lunches, right? This is way harder than that.
Absolutely.
A lot of science that goes into that. Well, that's the food element of the four. Anything to add to that before we go on to energy?
No, there's always so much to talk about, so I better stop on that one.
No, I mean, no, it's good, but I mean, people are getting the idea, which is the whole goal of the show, is that this is complicated, And doesn't mean don't do it. It doesn't mean don't get a bug out property. It just means there's a lot to think about. And if you have someone with some expertise, you can maybe not buy a property that you shouldn't buy or have confidence. That's a great thing. Going for the next 30 years saying, hot dog, we did it right here. You know, we got this place the way it needs to be. Or if you have a piece of property, knowing ways to improve it. So what, now we touched on energy a little bit. We were talking about wind and solar. Go ahead and you can, you know, we've got 12 minutes in this segment. You know, tell us about energy and how that applies to what you look at in a property and things to look for and things to avoid.
Great. So yeah, let's start with the typical off-grid scenario. Solar is really what people tend to think about as the most obvious, and it's a great one to consider, but I like to take one step back before you start to get into the different types of energy production systems, and say it's more about kind of a holistic mindset. And so what you really want to do is start off with, what are my long-term goals? What types of items that I want to be able to have or use on my property require energy, require electricity. And you want to try to make that as efficient as possible and reduce the overall energy demand on your property, or at least for those key systems you want to have keep functioning in the future, say in a grid down scenario or a post-collapse scenario. And by minimizing those consumptive energy needs, now I can minimize and reduce the size of an energy production system that I need. For some reason, a lot of folks just sort of get excited about it, and they go figure out what package they can afford from said distributor or supplier of, hey, this really cool solar system, and I'm going to throw up, you know, this solar array and a battery bank, and I'm off to the races. And they haven't really considered, is it the right size to meet their needs? And a lot of times it's undersized, but also sometimes people just invest way more than they needed, and it's not helpful. So after you've figured out what reasonably do you need, what size and scale system, solar panels are great, and a lot of people are really familiar with them. Micro hydroelectric, if you have a creek or a spring and some good terrain changes on the property, that can also be really effective. If folks are going to do that, it's really cool too to think about wind and hydroelectric production. They're a little bit different than solar in that they always, when they're producing energy, have to be able to push it out to somewhere. They can't just stop letting the energy flow, or they actually can backfeed and destroy themselves. And so they have these systems that, without getting into all the technical jargon, it'll basically take, if you don't need power feeding your battery bank or wherever else you're consuming it right now, they have systems that'll basically convert that energy into heat. And so having a way of taking that heat and putting it to some other use or storing it for other purposes is a great way to not lose that energy. A less known system for producing energy is you usually want to have a backup generator anyway, and sort of a dual fuel generator, if you will, maybe one that will run on gasoline and propane or diesel.
I'm a huge fan of dual fuel generators, yes.
Awesome. So this is not the generator itself, but the fuel source, wood gas. So back during World War II, right, we had a fuel shortage because we had to use all that fuel for the production and then shipment of items overseas for the war effort. Well, what did that mean? That meant the folks out in rural America that had to keep growing the food and supplying everyone, they didn't have the fuel to run the tractors and run the farm trucks and all that stuff. There was a crisis and a shortage, so they really pioneered and developed this wood gas system of taking chunks of wood, right, wood fuel, and taking the smoke, if you would, that comes off of that and condensing it down and actually piping that into an engine and running the engine off of this smoldering wood. And so there's a system for doing that efficiently, and it's an alternative to traditional fuels.
And I learned about this today, by the way. I'd heard of it, and I couldn't wrap my mind around the fact that you would burn some stuff and the smoke from it would either be the fuel source for a propane generator, as if the smoke was like propane, or you would just put this smoke and it's wood, little teeny bits of unburned stuff, you would put this smoke, we'll call it, like right into an air filter of a gasoline engine, and it would work. I thought, I can't get my mind around this, but, and Shelby, you saw this too. I mean,
I did too. And here's the thing.
It's a real thing.
It is a real thing, and it blows your mind a little bit. And that's, if I make a, can make a plug for it, these are the things you learn when you go to expos.
Exactly.
So go to expos, and when we tell you about them, go check it out. It's really kind of cool.
Exactly. And so, and then there's the, I love how you started with, think about what your energy needs are, because this was an epiphany, and I just came up with this on my own, you know, but because I had to come up with an energy plan at the cabin, and I had, you know, generator, and that's, well, pretty much it. And then I said, well, wait a second, and a battery bank. Hey, I don't need very much energy. I've maybe charged the refrigerator and the freezer, you know, a half hour a day or something. And I can run a ton of things on DC, direct current, and why take it up to, you know, 110 volts and then back down to 12. And by the way, a huge thing on 12 volt appliances, you can get so many things in 12 volts. So think of it this way, a crock pot that you plug into like a cigarette lighter in a car, but obviously it's not just a car, it'd be like a 12 volt, like a Goal Zero or something like that battery. And the reason there are so many 12-volt appliances out there is truckers. Go to a truck. This happened. This is a true story. A friend of mine, a great, great, nice guy, is homeless. And I would take him on occasion to the truck stop so he could shower. And so I'm hanging out at the truck stop, you know, for like a half an hour. And I'm walking up and down the aisles. And there are all these things. You can cook with 12-volt DC. They have coolers that are not exactly refrigerators. There are 12-volt refrigerators too. And you can do a ton of the things that you really need to do. Like, let's say you need to keep insulin cool. You can do that with 12 volts. The crock pot is a great thing. And so it's almost, and this is going to be a weird concept, it's almost normalcy bias when it comes to your energy needs. Oh, I need to power the whole home, and I need to have a microwave going at the same time, the hot tub is going at the same time, all these things are going. No, you don't. You need to keep insulin cool or whatever it might be, and maybe have a crock pot going, you know, all day long. So I love that on energy. What are some other energy thoughts when you're looking at a property?
Solar exposure is obviously important. And another sort of, if you will, efficiency perspective is, right, you usually have to think about heating your, at least your home and maybe some of your outbuildings. Passive solar heating is a great thing to look at, especially if you haven't built yet or you're planning to do renovations or additions.
And what is that, just in case people are unfamiliar?
Yeah, so it's just literally using the heat of the sun. So think about, right, on a glorious sunny day, you stand in front of your big bay window, and you're just absorbing all that solar energy. You're just getting warmed by the sun, or your cat or your dog are laying in the sunny spot instead of the shady spot on the floor. The way we take advantage of that is good exposure, having all the glass in the proper places, and then creating some sort of really dense area, really heavy thermal mass. So that might be stone, it might be brick, or some concrete, similar kind of masonry, something that's really thick and heavy, and having that material absorb the heat from the sun as it comes in through the window. And basically it's kind of like a battery for heat. It's storing that heat, and then as the sun passes by and the day is getting cooler into the evening, right now it's radiating that heat and letting it back out and heating up the space. And the way you do that in a really smart and intelligent manner is you also can build some solar shades into that south-facing part of the house where all that glass is. And those will be designed in such a way that how far they extend off the face of the house above the glass, we looked at depending on the sun angle in the summer versus the winter. So that in the height of summer, when you really don't want the house to keep heating up, it will actually block and shade those windows from the sun. But then as the sun angle drops down, it can come in underneath that overhang and let the winter sun come in to heat the house. So things like that are super simple once they're planned properly to execute when it comes to construction, but they can significantly reduce the amount of energy you need to put into the home to heat it. Some other cool examples of heating the house that people may not be aware of would be, say, a compost mound. Big old heap of wood chips, big old heap of manure. The middle of that, as all the microbial activity is going on and those little bugs are in there digesting everything and letting out gas and moving around, they're producing heat. And so the center of a traditional mound of composting material will be somewhere between about 140 and 155 degrees. So if you put a coil of water-filled tubing in the middle of that and circulate it back somewhere into the home, it's kind of like having a radiant heating system like people spend a lot of money to put into the floors of their house. And you can draw heat off of that natural source that you're using to turn into compost for your gardens anyway and get multiple uses out of it.
What about another power source for a homestead being a small nuclear power reactor? What do you feel about those? How's that? I mean, is that a good idea?
I'm going to have to defer to like maybe a submariner or something.
That
see
might
if somebody,
need a permit.
I think need some permits for
there
that.
Might be some,
there might
that's
be
some
a
government
permitting process
permitting,
there.
Yeah.
And you know, military grade kind
yeah.
of stuff. Yeah, I don't
maybe
think
that's
so.
That's a terrible idea.
Yeah. Talk to the realtor about that.
Yeah, the realtor, I'm sure, will know if you can put a backyard nuclear reactor in.
Remind me, please, to add to my website, not an expert in this area.
Yeah, in that. No,
well,
I was just throwing that at
you. And we only have
you.
Like 30 seconds here. Real quick, Brian, if people want to reach you and get one of your great consultations, where can they reach you?
The best thing to do is go to my website. I've got a number of contact methods there, and it is strategiclandscapedesign.com.
Awesome. So for those of you who listen in on our Patreon show, our after show, stay tuned. We're going to talk some more kind of details with Brian from Strategic Landscape Designs. I always like to leave people with one of my favorite quotes from Benjamin Franklin. Failing to prepare is preparing to fail. I hope everyone has a great week. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for joining us today as well, Brian. It's been great. I know we're all a little tired today, but it's been a great day in terms of meeting some great fans and some great preppers and some great just patriots out here in Liberty State. Everyone have a great week.
Bye.
You've been listening to Prepping 2.0 with authors Shelby Gallagher and Glenn Tate. All of the fun and easy prepping information heard on this podcast can be found online at prepping2-0.com. You can also find out more about Glenn's books online at 299days.com and about Shelby's books online at agreatstate.com. Until next time, be smart, be safe, and be prepared.